So, Americans love many things, of course. But for one thing we sure do love is winning. Some may joke about a particular leader of ours who shall remain nameless, who likes to use the language of winning really big. But we would be kidding ourselves if we didn't recognize that same sense that we have towards aspirations of success and achievement and winning. Somehow we've all bought into the idea that if someone is successful, then in whatever area of life that may be, then it must be due to that person's sense of strength, gifting, or skill. If a doctor, lawyer, or CEO is really successful in life, then it must be due to their level of intellect or cognitive ability. If a professional athlete is super successful, then it has to be due to their natural giftings physically, or just their sheer will to work really hard towards the goal, whatever that may be for them. Or if an artist or musician is really successful, then it must be due to their natural skill or their beauty or their charisma. And we wouldn't, you know, we wouldn't be honest if we didn't say the church had a lot of aspirations towards success as well. We sometimes get pulled into viewing the church through the lens of growth and the attractional quotient. So how many people are in your church? How fast is it growing, you know, since a couple years ago? How many programs do you offer? What kind of programs do you offer? How culturally relevant is your church? Is the preaching really good? Is the worship music awesome? Do kids love the children's ministry? Are there a ton of things for the kids to do that keep them entertained and happy? You know, same as the youth group. On and on it goes. So it's obvious we like to rely on our dominant side, which makes us feel strong and secure. And while strength is certainly nothing bad in and of itself, how does this showcasing of our strength relate to God's glory? And especially in the face of the unknown, what do you, I'll ask you, the audience, what do you prefer to rely on for your sense of security, for your sense of purpose, and for your own identity and glory? What do you rely on in those times of the unknown? In our passage today, we'll be looking at the book of Judges, and we'll look at how a particular individual handled a situation where they had to choose between relying on their own strength or relying on something else. In this life of Gideon, this is the particular individual, we'll see how we should live so that God can use us for his purposes. So let's open up our Bibles to chapter 7 of Judges, and we'll be reading the chapter primarily in its entirety, a couple verses short though. So begin with me. Then Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all the people who were with him rose early and encamped beside the spring of Herod. And the camp of Midian was north of them, by the hill of Morah in the valley. Then the Lord said to Gideon, "The people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, 'My own hand has saved me.' Now therefore proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, 'Whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead.' Then 22,000 of the people returned, and 10,000 remained. And the Lord said to Gideon, 'The people are still too many. Take them down to the water, and I will test them there for you there. And anyone of whom I say to you, 'This one shall go with you,' shall go with you. And anyone of whom I say to you, 'This one shall not go with you,' shall not go." So he brought the people down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, "Everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, you shall set by himself. Likewise, everyone who kneels down to drink." And the number of those who lapped, putting their hands to their mouths, was 300 men. But all the rest of the people knelt down to drink water. And the Lord said to Gideon, "With the 300 men who lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hand, and let all the others go, every man to his home." So the people took provisions in their hands and their trumpets, and he sent all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, but retained the 300 men. And the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. That same night the Lord said to him, Arise, go down to the camp, for I have given it into your hand. But if you are afraid to go down the camp to the camp with Pura, your servant, and you shall hear what they say. And afterward, your hands shall be strengthened to go down against the camp. Then he went down with Pura, his servant, to the outposts of the armed men who were in the camp. And the Midianites and the Amalekites and all the people of the east along the valley were like locusts in abundance, and their camels were without number, as the sand that is on the seashore in abundance. When Gideon came, behold, a man was telling a dream to his comrade, and he said, Behold, I dreamed a dream, and behold, a cake of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian and came to the tent and struck it so that it fell and turned it upside down, so that the tent lay flat. And his comrade answered, There is no other than the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, a man of Israel. God has given into his hand Midian and all the camp. As soon as Gideon heard the telling of the dream and its interpretation, he worshipped. And he returned to the camp of Israel and said, Arise, for the Lord has given the host of Midian into your hand. And he divided 300 men into three companies and put trumpets into the hands of all of them and empty jars with torches inside the jars. And he said to them, Look at me and do likewise. When I come to the outskirts of the camp, do as I do. When I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me blow the trumpet. Then blow the trumpets on also every side of all the camp and shout for the Lord and for Gideon. So, right before this, actually, it's really important to understand that Gideon had followed the call of the Lord on his life to deliver Israel from the oppressing hand of the Midianites and the Amalekites. So acting as an act of obedience and following God, Gideon follows God's instruction to destroy the false altars, or the altars of the false gods of the Midianites and the Amalekites. And this, of course, Gideon knew was going to bring about hostility from the oppressing Midianites, who really had control over the Israelites over that time. And God had called him out to be the deliverer of the Israelites. So this was going to set the stage for a battle, Gideon knew. Because in response to the altars of the false gods of Baal, who the Midianites and Amalekites worshipped, they encamped in the valley. And Gideon had sent out word for military support from Israel, and he got quite a response. He got 32,000 men, which is quite an army. I mean, especially even in those days, for sure. But God, after Gideon gets this 32,000 army of men, God does something rather curious here. He says to Gideon that there's too many that are fighting on your behalf. And I don't know about you, I have to confess, I've never served in the military. But I would definitely want more soldiers than less soldiers if I were in a battle. And God's reasoning here for cutting down Gideon's army is because God says that Gideon will get the glory instead of God. God says that if in the event of a Midianite, Amalekite defeat with Israel winning, the crowds would be shouting, Hooray, Gideon, instead of praise God. And so it's something we see kind of in Scripture elsewhere too, that God is very jealous for his own glory. And in any other place, we would really kind of see this as a negative trait. And probably even when we read it in the Bible, we kind of see it as a negative trait. But when we think about it, God is jealous for his glory, and he is the only one that is absolutely worthy of that glory and of worship. So it's actually a positive attribute when we see it in personalized in the act of God. But make no mistake here, even in spite of all of this, Gideon knowing that God was on his side and still asking him to do this, Gideon finds himself in a battle. In this, and it clearly has spiritual overtones to it, and we can see that, you know, not every military conflict here in this world has as strong of spiritual implications as Gideon's battle does here, But perhaps you find yourself in a battle here today, maybe many battles, and maybe some of them seem more spiritually overt, maybe others it's more subtle or mundane. But let me assure you that whatever you depend on during those battles will make it a spiritual battle. If you have found it hard to maybe live the lifestyle that you want, or maybe you're having difficulty keeping up with living within your means, the way that you go about solving that problem of solving any financial issue that you have, and maybe even you don't, just the way you go about handling money is going to show where your heart lies. Obviously, of course, Jesus goes in this talking about money is a litmus test of the heart. Or maybe you're seeking for love and acceptance in the midst of all the relationships around you. The way you go about solving that battle of finding identity and peace and security will also show where your heart lies. So the battles around us, especially in our own hearts, will show where our heart lies, just as Gideon was going to find out where his heart lied in this story in the Old Testament here. So going back to Gideon, and regarding where he's going to place his strength, it's no easy choice here for Gideon. But he appears to do it at least with not too much complaining here, which is to Gideon's credit here. But God also does use a kind of a peculiar method for whittling down Gideon's army. And some may say that maybe it's because God was trying to purify the army and just leave Gideon with the strongest amount of men left possible. Kind of in like the Spartan army of the 300 men, who obviously were pretty stout military guys, at least according to the legend. But anyways, for God, there doesn't appear to be a rhyme or reason. Even if some commentators say that the men who lapped the water and were sent away, maybe they were the weaker ones, but we're not really told this from the text, that they were weaker or that they were less capable soldiers. So in any event, it appears to be a rather kind of arbitrary way that God uses, at least from our perspective. It's a mystery. It would perhaps be the right word to describe the way that God whittles down these men. And he whittles them down from 32,000 to 300. This is an incredible reduction here. And so, of course, as church folk, we know how the rest of the story goes. In the face of incredible odds, kind of like David and Goliath, just trust God and everything will work out in your favor, right? So, but we know that we've all been faced with similar circumstances in life, and it's not our natural tendency to just trust God. We naturally want to trust anything else but God. We want to appeal to our sense of strength and whatever else that we're involved in, or what God has given us as a natural gifting. So when we put ourselves into Gideon's shoes, really try to feel the weight of the temptation he had to trust the material world of the military strength that he really had at the beginning of these 32,000 men, and going down to less than 1% of what he had at the beginning, from 32,000 to 300, going up a vast army who was very capable of taking out little Israel of 300 men. So in other ways, bringing it down to our lives today, how has God pushed you towards a vulnerability in your life? It probably came with the absence of something maybe in your life that God took away. Has he taken away a job from you? Maybe if not now, in the past, has he done that? And how did you get through that? Has he taken away a parent maybe from you? Has he taken away the loss of a child? Has he taken away maybe what your future looked like? What you wished it would look like, or what you thought it was going to look like. These would be places of vulnerability for sure that God can take away, situations in our life, where we view ourselves as strong or things in our life as strong. Perhaps maybe you've even lost your faith, throughout your life, and that what used to be a place of strength for you. And in that case, I don't believe that God would take your faith away, but maybe it's something that you wish you could get back. And, or maybe you struggle with doubt, and this is a time when I don't believe doubt during a believer's faith journey is necessarily something bad or evil. I think it can be definitely a source of strength. I can think of a time in my own life when I was really having serious intellectual doubts about my faith. I was talking with this agnostic friend of mine, and although I had done some, reading and some thinking about the battle between, in a lot of, it's probably more of a Western believer conversation, but of, God's sovereignty and human free will, and just the difficulties that come when you try to have both of those things existing together, at least in our minds, it's a difficult thing. And this agnostic friend was really challenging me in some areas that I hadn't been challenged before when thinking about this. And it caused me to really reconsider my faith. But God led me to some mature believers in the faith who were able to direct me to resources and have conversations that helped solidify and strengthen my cognitive, the cognitive side of my faith in Jesus and as a follower of Christ. And although that there was a period though where I was unsure, I struggled with doubt. I was kind of in between. I wasn't sure what I believed, but God used that time, that period of doubt, to call me back to Him and to really pursue me. I felt pursued by God through the midst of that. And we can see in the battle that Gideon is going through here that God is fully aware of Gideon's doubt, in spite of the assurance, and even at the beginning when Gideon was first responding to the call of God on his life to destroy the altars of Baal, Gideon was unsure of God's calling on him and his ability. Kind of resembles a bit the burning bush experience that Moses had and the reluctance that Moses had as a leader or in becoming a leader. So God here clearly knows that we doubt as humans, and especially when He calls us to do things in obedience to Him. So God is fully aware of our doubts, like I've said, and it doesn't scare Him. It doesn't make Him back away from us, but He just further pursues us, and He was so gracious, as we see towards Gideon, in allowing him to go down into the Midianite Amalekite camp, and really see further assurance that they were going to win the battle, to help give him strength as a leader of these 300 men that were left. And I'm sure Gideon had thoughts going through his mind at the time, why he had those doubts. Was he going to be a little asterisk in the history books of time, talking about how foolish he was to go into this battle with 300 men, thinking that he was going to win or anything like that? This was for sure a time for Gideon when the battle was such at a disadvantage that it would seem, in any other case, it would seem like pure folly, pure foolishness for a leader to even attempt some kind of a battle like this, than even, surrender or anything like that. But yes, as we see, God gave victory to Gideon in the end in this battle, and in a battle that was disproportionately in favor of the Amalekites and the Midians. But God got all the glory here. He got the praise and the glory because of the weakness that Gideon pressed into. He pressed into his own weakness. He along with all the soldiers that were with him too, I'm sure they were doubting at some point. I'm sure by the end of it that they they had followed the call of Gideon and trusting that in God's favor on him. But in a disproportionate battle, Gideon pressed into his weakness and showed that God was worthy of the praise and honor to be obedient to, and that he didn't need to rely on his military numbers, but could rely on the one person on his side who could really give him the glory, an army of one, almost, you could say. But when it comes to our lives, again, bringing this down to earth for us, when confronted with situations where we're fearful, where we're uncertain, where the pace of our life or the path of our life appears unclear, what we place our hope in, what other kind of strength do we try to rely on? About a year ago, my wife and I, before becoming a part of this church plant that we're currently a part of, we were living 30 minutes away in North Canton, a suburb of Canton in Ohio here, and we were struggling about knowing exactly where to move. We knew we wanted to move and join this church plant in Akron, but we weren't quite sure where, didn't know the neighborhoods really well, and so this was definitely a time of uncertainty, and really there was some fear and anxiety involved. We have three kids and didn't know exactly where we were going to go. And, you know, regarding schooling and all of those questions, of course, that as a parent you go through. So we knew we were having to trust God in that, but we still felt some hesitation and some trepidation about the experience. The community that we had been living in, we'd been there for 6 years, and we'd really planted some good roots in the community, really had some great relationships, and it was really out of those relationships in the church there that spawned this church plant. So we knew we were being sent in love, and being just 30 minutes away, we weren't really totally jumping out of the nest. We're still able to be in contact with them, but it was a real period of it was a real trial for Kara and I as we tried to move towards Akron. Here we sold our house in North Canton, and there was a time when after we sold our house and while we were waiting to buy the house here in Akron that we're in, we had to stay with some friends of ours, we had to stay with Kara's parents, and we really didn't know how long it was going to be till we were going to be living in Akron. And just that period of unknown, of being unsettled, of being displaced, was an incredibly uncomfortable feeling. Of course, it caused us to look to God and to really place our hope in Him ultimately, because I remember being totally at my wit's end so many days, and just wanting to have a home to go to. And it was a real period where Kara would, my wife would preach to me, and she would talk about her own struggle with it, and she would say that God was really searching her own heart and saying, "Stop worrying about this earthly home that you're trying to be in, but prepare your heart to be a home where I can live." And so it was a real message to me as well to hear that God wanted us to be more focused on Him living in us than about us being so concerned about where we were going to live, because God took care of us every step of the way through friends and family until we eventually arrived in the very house that I'm in today. So let's kind of move to the end of the story here. One thing is certain here, as a result of going through the story of Gideon here, the areas where we really feel powerful or strong in, they're going to fail us. While we may not be leading armies into the battle, there are obviously other ways that the spiritual components of our life, the spiritual battles in our life, are going to occur. Someday our bank accounts are going to fail us. Someday our strength is going to fail us. Someday our minds are going to fail us. Someday our jobs will fail us. one day our spouse will no longer be there, or we will no longer be there for our spouse. One day our kids will no longer be there, or we will no longer be there for our kids. One day our parents will no longer be there for us. Everything in this life will eventually break down and no longer be there. All of our strength today will no longer be strengths tomorrow or someday. So I work in a nursing home during the day, during the week, in the therapy department. And over the past 7 years of working in the nursing home, I've seen the realities of people grappling with losing the strengths that I've listed above, with these people losing. And I'll tell you, the brothers and the sisters in Christ that I've seen in their old age that I've interacted with, it's they, and seeing them, how they've placed their strength, not in ultimately those things, although they experienced grief and sadness and loss and losing their families and not being able to be as independent with their jobs. Of course, that brings them sadness, but ultimately, you could see a sweet passion in their eyes and in their lives for Jesus, and to just be a display for honoring God throughout their whole lives, even up until the very end. And that is truly beautiful, to see how they've pressed into the weakness of their lives. And to me, God gets so much of the glory in that, when I've seen people in their 70s, 80s, 90s, and seemingly they've lost everything. But the few that have really embraced that period of their life to really still say, blessed be the name of the Lord, praise the Lord, whether he give me or take from me, give to me or take from me, those have been one of the most beautiful things that I've seen working in the nursing home. And I pray that for each of us, as we've seen in Gideon, as I've seen in people in their last stages and moments of life, may we press into the moments of weakness that we're placed into, so that this hidden display of glory to God may be finally brought about and bring him the most glory in an unsuspecting way. Let's pray. God, thank you for pursuing us, God. Thank you for being there with us side by side, no matter our performance, God, in spite of us, just because you love us, God. Thank you for being gracious with us, even when we're not the most obedient, God, in spite of everything that we have that shows us that you are worthy of trust. You are worthy of our trust and of our of complete abandonment to follow you, God. But thank you for being with us in those moments of doubt and uncertainty, God. And may we not look to the things that we want to put our strength in for our sense of security, purpose, and peace, and sense of identity, God. But may we look to you, and may we just really see that truly, God, when we are weak, you are strong, God. So thank you so much in sending your son Jesus, God, to really show us the way to lay ourselves down for you, God, to not show our strength, God, but to show your strength. Thank you, Lord, for all of these things, and in your name we pray. Amen.